Hey everyone, welcome back to Introduction to Bifrost Visual Programming. In the previous tutorial, I covered the basic setup of simulations. Today we're going to use what we've learned to create some fog for our landscape. Here's the landscape and scattered mesh spheres that we created before. You can download this file in the description. The spheres at the top of the mountains will be used as the source geometry for the fog. First, let's create a new graph for setting up the simulation. Middle drag Bifrost Graph 1, which is the graph we use to create the mountains, into this new graph. This way we can access the outputs from one graph and use them as the inputs in another graph. Using multiple graphs for complex scenes or procedures not only make things more organized, but also helps with the performance, since the upstream graph won't be computed unless necessary. Connect the mountains to output and hide the first graph. To simulate the fog, let's get a basic arrow graph and explode it. Connect the mesh spheres for the fog to geometry. This will be the source of our simulation. Let's get an assigned material and create a volume material in Hypershade. Select AI Standard Volume. Go to Presets and select Default Bifrost Arrow and click Replace. This preset automatically fills in the properties produced by arrow simulations. Bring it to the graph. Connect it to volume material and the out geometry to the output. If we run it now, we see air coming out of those spheres. Let's adjust some of the parameters of the shader. Bring down the density to 0.25 so that it doesn't look too heavy. We also want to give it a whiter scatter color by increasing the RGB values. Let's do 6 here. Increase the weight of transparency and reduce the depth to 0.1. This gives it a more translucent appearance. To make it look more like fog, let's adjust some of the parameters of source air. Let's switch the resolution mode to absolute to get a higher resolution. If we change the geovolume mode to shell, the air will be emitted only from the surface of the geometry. And we can increase the geo detail size as well as the fluid detail size so that we have larger voxels. The default fog density mode is rate, meaning that starting from zero density, the air is gradually emitted into the voxels with a time-dependent rate to reach the fog density that we set. If we change the mode to add, then it starts with the set fog density and keeps adding this amount to each voxel so that the air becomes increasingly thicker. In this case, we're good with rate. For the temperature, we can use the set mode to get a constant temperature, say 20 degrees Celsius. And to imitate the appearance of fog or mist, we want to use a small number for the fog density, which gives it a nice translucency and lightness. Let's enter 0.4 here. We can give it an initial speed, say 2.5, towards, for example, the negative z direction. In the arrow solver settings, make sure the style is set to smooth. Here's a rendered view of the scene. If we want the fog to have more details, one thing we can do is to adjust the scene unit here. When the size of the scene is very different from its true physical size, it helps to change the scene unit so that the simulation runs in a more correct scale. For example, in this case, the scale of our model is much smaller than that of a real landscape. If we increase the scene unit to 6, it means every unit in the scene equals 6 meters instead of 1 meter. And as a result of this enlarged simulation scale, the fluid detail would appear smaller. Let's run the simulation. Because of the increased scale, it takes a while for the fog to build up. At this moment, the air looks too sporadic. Let's increase the number of the emitters. Turn on the display of graph 1. Click Create Instances Fog. Decrease the spacing and increase the size so that the meshes cover a good amount of the top area. When we modify the upstream graph, the inputs for the downstream graph get updated automatically. Hide graph 1. Run the simulation. And we see a better form and continuity. Here's a rendered image of the result. We can see that the fog has become lighter and more detailed. Now let's add some influences. We can get a dissipation influence to control how fast the vapor decays. If we want the fog to permeate a larger area, we use a small dissipation rate. You can also right-click at the port to access some of the commonly used influences. Let's also add a vorticity influence to stir up the air. At this moment, all the influences are applied uniformly to every voxel. We can use the node modulate influence to scale the amount of the effect based on a property. For example, if we set the property to be voxel fog density and enter 0.01 and 0.03 for min and max, then the voxels with the fog density below 0.01 will not be affected by the vorticity influence, and the voxels with the fog density above 0.03 will get the maximum effect. Everything in between will have a scaled effect accordingly. To make the scene more dynamic, we can use wind to trigger the movement of the fog. And we can introduce fluctuations in parameters such as wind direction. One way of doing it is to use a noise function to drive the change. Let's get a fractal turbulence, as well as a time node. Connect seconds to time and plug in a position here. Any position would work in this case. The output is a vector with a magnitude between negative 1 and 1. And when we simulate it, we'll get a coherent evolution of values for both magnitude and direction over time. To scale this turbulence vector, we can multiply it with a vector 3, say 0.1, 0.5, 0.1. This way, the fluctuation will mainly occur in the y direction. Then let's add it to a base vector of 0, 0, negative 1. This makes the wind blow mainly towards the negative z direction with up and down drafts. Connect it to wind direction. If we animate it, we see the movement of the fog. Here are some rendered images after applying wind. Besides wind, we can also animate colors. In this image, the mixture of orange and purple vapors is a result from creating a transition and oscillation between these two colors when generating the source air. As shown in this diagram, the transition and oscillation are achieved through establishing a relationship between the frame count and the color. We can use a combination of time, evaluate F-curve, and linear interpolate to realize that. First, we want to be able to adjust the frequency to control how fast the color changes. To do that, we can multiply the frame count with a value. This value acts as a scalar, through which we can change the frequency. To create a color, we need three numbers for its R, G, and B values, and we use a vector 3 value to represent it. Enter the RGB values for this purple color. Copy and paste it, and enter the values for this orange. Connect them to first and second, respectively. For the fraction, we use this evaluate F curve to generate a number between 0 and 1 based on the frame count. Here we can change the pre and post extrapolation from constant to oscillate, and we can modify the shape of the curve. Connect it to fraction. This way, for each frame, it calculates the fraction number. And the linear interpolate node will return the interpolation of the two colors at this fraction. To set the color as a property of the source air, we can use the node set property. Connect the interpolated colors to value and name the key air color. And connect the out object to additional properties. There's one more thing we need to do to render the color. Click the graph and go to the material we created for the fog. Set the color channel to be voxel underscore plus whatever name we just used as the key to the property. In this case, it should be voxel air color. Now if we run it and render the scene, we have this colorful fog. As we see, although we have the animation working, the playback speed is pretty slow because it's calculating the simulation for each frame. To improve the playback speed, we can cache the simulation and read from the cache files during the playback. We can use the node file cache to do that. Set the mode to write and select the folder where you want to store those files. Name the files. The pangs here indicate a sequence of numbers. Connect the simulation output to objects, and the first object to assign material. Now if we play it, we see the cache files being saved in the destination folder. After the cache is complete, we switch to the read mode. Play it again, and we get a much faster speed. Here's a rendered animation of the scene. That's it for today. In the next tutorial, we'll create bonfires in the valleys. Thanks for watching, stay tuned, and I'll see you next time.